Welcome to our last set of notes in Unit 2 on research. We're going to talk about how psychologists ask and answer questions given their research and the statistics that they can then describe and infer from that research. So just to kind of give an idea of what statistical reasoning might be, statistical procedures, the statistics end up helping you to analyze and interpret data. And they let us see what the unaided eye might miss, right? So like you have all of this data, but statistics kind of organizes it for you in a way that can be interpreted and give you more information. There's describing data that we can get from statistics. The meaningful description of data is important. Or misrepresentation can lead to incorrect conclusions. Just looking at these two graphs, the graph on the left here is kind of a more backed out version, right? Like the percentage still functioning after 10 years from 0 to 100% shows very little variation in those four columns. But if you zoom in from 95 to 100%, it looks as if there's a lot of variation, right? There can be a misrepresentation there. Measures of central tendency in statistics. This is hopefully just a reminder for you from most of your math classes. The mean being the average of scores in a distribution. You add them up and divide by the total number of numbers, right? The median being the middle score in a rank order distribution. So you would put numbers in order, successive order, right? And you would find the exact middle number. And then the mode is the most frequently occurring. It's the most, mode most. Median, middle, mode most. It's the most frequently occurring score in a distribution. So if you have four 13s, 13 could be the most frequently occurring number. So we do have measures of central tendency, mean, median, mode, but then we also have measures of variation. And a lot of times in a test question, they'll ask you to identify a measure of central tendency. It's good to know what then measures of variation are because you can eliminate those from the options, right? Like having knowledge of both is good. The range is the difference between the highest and lowest scores in a distribution. So if scores range from a 42% all the way up to a 98%, right, the lowest and highest score, that would be your range. Standard deviation would be the average difference, the standard or average difference or deviation between each score and the mean. Okay, so how much of a difference is there? What is the average difference between the mean and each of the scores? So a large standard deviation on this graph here is indicated in the blue distribution. So the more spread out scores are from the mean, noticing that there's not a lot right in the center, they're kind of spread out accordingly. And then the small standard deviation being indicated in the red, so there's more scores bunched together around the mean. If there's a small standard deviation, which is deviation or a difference from the mean, there's not going to be very many scores away from the mean. Calculating standard deviation. I've got quite a few slides here about how to calculate standard deviation. There's a big long formula to it and organizing of numbers, but the good thing is that often you're not going to be asked to actually calculate standard deviation. I'm telling you that they will not ask you to calculate it. But you do need to apply it conceptually. You have to apply what you know of the concept of standard deviation. For example, you'll see a test question like this quite often. Which of the following sets of data has the greatest standard deviation? And you have those three bullet points, right? So how do you figure this out? You can estimate standard deviation by looking at the spread of numbers or the range of numbers. So 1 to 30, that is a range of 30. 5 to 18, not as much range there. 30 to 35, even less range. You can find the mean and compare each number to the mean. That would take a little longer, so I would recommend the first option. But even looking, okay, what's the difference between 1 and 5? Okay, 5. What's the difference between 5 and 7? 2. 7 and 30? A lot more than 2, right? So there's a lot of deviation there. So standard deviation is indicated on a normal distribution of scores. It's a distribution of any scores, like on a test, intelligence test, driver's test, anything like that, that produces a bell-shaped and symmetrical curve, right? It's exactly the same on either side. There's no outlying data that's going to skew and make it asymmetrical. In this quote normal curve, the mean, median, mode fall at exactly the same point. Okay, so it's so symmetrical that the mean is not being pulled one way or the other because of outliers, outlying extreme scores. So the span of one standard deviation on either side of the mean covers approximately 68.2% of the scores in the normal distribution. And we'll show you the breakdown of those percentages here in a minute. But this IQ normal curve shows the normal distribution of IQ scores. And if you look here in the center line of zero, that would be zero standard deviations away from the mean because it is the mean. And then the Wechsler IQ and Sanford-Binet IQ, the average IQ is 100. And then most people falling within 15 points, which is the standard deviation of 15, within one standard deviation above and below the mean, which would equate 68.2% of people. So this is all the 68.2 stuff that I'm talking about here. This is the normal curve, and these percentages you need to memorize. What I recommend is that you memorize one half of the curve. If you memorize one half, you know the other half, and you can calculate all of these percentages down here. Okay, so the mean is the center line, and one key percentage to know is that 50% of all scores lie at the mean and below, and then the other 50% at the mean and above, right? Half of the curve equals 50% of scores. 50% of people score either above or below. So then you've got 34.1 within one standard deviation. That's one jump, right? So from the mean to the next line down, that is one jump. That is one standard deviation, which depending on the distribution of scores and what the mean is, the standard deviation will change. These lines will never change on a normal curve. It's just the value will change. Sometimes the standard deviation could be 5 points. Sometimes it could be 15 points or 20 points. Okay, it's all a matter of what one standard deviation equals. But each one of these jumps, each one of these lines, is one standard deviation. So one standard deviation above or below the mean is 34.1%. So one standard deviation from the mean on above or below would be 68.2%. And then from one to two standard deviations would be 13.6, which would give you within two standard deviations of the mean 95.4%. And then the percentage fall on out from there. I would like for you to memorize 34.1, 13.6, and 2.1. And then you can memorize the 0.1%, but that's so minuscule. And of course, the 50%. I want you to memorize all of those percentages. So measures of central tendency in a skewed distribution is going to look differently. The curve is not going to be normal, right? It's going to be skewed, which I'll show you some pictures of. But you notice, look at the mode, median, and mean here. The mean is very impacted by skewed data. The 90, 475, and 710, those are what you would call outliers. Those are extreme scores. Now, these are extremely positive or extremely high scores. So this would show a positive skew of the distribution. Notice that the mean is what is most impacted. You should write that down in your notes. What measure of central tendency is most impacted by outlying data? It would be the mean. Your median is what is still most reliable. So these are the two pictures of skewed distributions, okay? So what I want you to recognize is that the skew is when it's lower to the bottom here, right? There are very few people scoring where the kind of tail is on each of these graphs. Right? There's very few people scoring there. That's where your outliers are, where your extreme scores. So in a negative skew, the skew or the extreme outlier is on the negative or lower end. Okay, it's not necessarily negative, but it's on the lower end, so think closer to negative numbers. So the majority of scores are actually above the mean and are over here on the higher end. Whereas one or a few extremely low scores cause the mean to be less than the median score in a skew. Whereas in a positive skew, the majority of scores are below the mean, and the skew or the outlier, one or a few of them, are extremely high scores, and they draw the mean away from the median towards the top end of the scores. So we're done talking about descriptive statistics, mean, median, mode, measures of variation, etc. Let's talk about inferential statistics. These involve estimating what is happening in a sample population for the purpose of making decisions about the population's characteristics. Okay, it's based in probability theory. In that if this is happening in my sample, I'm able to generalize to my population, inferential statistics. Basically, these statistics allow us to say if it worked for this population or this sample, we can estimate that it will work for the rest of the population. So for instance, in drug testing, if the meds worked for the sample, like if you're testing the effectiveness of oxycodone, we estimate that it will have the same effects on the rest of the population because we have inferential statistics. There's always a chance for error in whatever the findings may be, so the hypothesis and results must be tested for a null, which we're going to talk about. So there's always space for error here, so all hypotheses have to be tested with a null, which is just the opposite or the lack of your hypothesis. It states that there is no difference between two sets of data. So the purpose of a null hypothesis is that until the research shows, by proving the original alternative hypothesis, that there is a difference, the researcher must assume that any difference present is due to chance. It's like innocent until proven guilty. You are wrong until you prove yourself right, is the purpose of the null. So if you look in this graph up at the top, you've got the truth about the population and that the null, being the opposite of your hypothesis, is true. And if the null is false, meaning your hypothesis is true. And then the decision the researcher makes, these are the type of errors that they could make. So a type one error, if the null or if your actual hypothesis is not true, but you reject that, you reject the null choosing the original hypothesis, but the null is actually true. You're wrong. You're publishing incorrect data there. Whereas type 2 error, you accept the null, yet the original hypothesis, what you wanted to be correct, was actually correct. You're like second guessing yourself in an order to kind of cover your booty, but you really don't have to. You were right. So let's say the original hypothesis is that a bomb threat was called into the front office, so we need to evacuate the school. No, this is not true. This is just an example for our purposes. So the null would be there is no bomb in the school, so we don't need to evacuate. And then this is where the type 2 and type 1 errors would be. Type 1 error would be we've evacuated the students, but the bomb squad didn't find anything, so we erred on the side of caution. Whereas the type 2 error, the bomb threat is ignored, student stays in class, and people are injured. That's not good. The big whammy of inferential statistics is statistical significance. And this is really important. It's something that you will see on the test and possibly even on an FRQ. Statistical significance says that my data is significant. The research that I did with my control group and experimental group, independent and dependent variable, means something. That the difference between my experimental and control group was caused by the independent variable and not by chance. So the definition is that difference observed between two sample groups is probably not due to chance. The difference instead is likely due to a real difference between the samples. So the data is significant, it's influential, when the likelihood of a difference being due to chance is less than 5% or 5 times out of 100. So in other words, there is a 95% or greater chance, likelihood, that any difference is due to your independent variable. And that's great. That's what you want. And this is shown numerically in what's called a p-value. And you should write that down, p-value. Your p-value must be less than or equal to 0.05 or 5%. What this is saying is that only 5% of your research was due to chance. That's the kind of the cutoff. That's the line that then says, okay, if you're no more than 5%, your data, your research is statistically significant. Meaning you can go forward and say, look, I'm right, or not necessarily right, but my independent variable is what caused this difference. It's true. My hypothesis is significant. It's influential. It's important because if research is statistically significant, it means that the results are probably not a fluke and probably not due to chance. And that's what a researcher must have.